Sup guys, Merkeebs here. Today we'll be checking out the EpoMaker EK68, a really impressive pre-built keyboard that needs little to no modding. As usual, quick disclaimer. EpoMaker did send this board out for review, but I was not paid or directed to say any specifics about the board. All thoughts and opinions about the product are always my own, and this video was not screened prior to publishing. Now with those formalities out of the way, now onto the review. So the board is available from EpoMaker's website. The board is priced at $89.99 and is available in two keycap variants. A black and gold variant, which we have here, and a black and purple variant. Then you have your choice of switches between the EpoMaker Flamingo Linears, EpoMaker Budregar Tactiles, and good old Gateron Yellow Pro Linears. Now for the unboxing. Opening up the box, you get the board itself wrapped in some plastic. And then you get a braided USB Type-C to Type-A cable, a combo switch and keycap puller, some extra accent keycaps, three extra switches depending on which switch you go for, and the quick start guide. Now let's look at the board. The board is a 65% layout with a blocker next to the arrow keys, which also functions as status indicators for battery and power. Then on the top right of the board you'll find the volume knob. A pretty simple design overall, that really makes use of all the usable space on the face of the board. One thing I want to mention is that when I was looking at photos for the board prior to reviewing it, I actually thought this board was going to be made of aluminum, but to my surprise, the board is actually made of plastic with a matte faux aluminum finish. A pretty neat design overall. It doesn't feel cheap and is decently built without any signs of corner cutting anywhere. The board is made of a two-piece construction with a pretty unique looking side profile. The board is wireless capable with support for 2.4 GHz wireless and Bluetooth connectivity. On the back of the board, you'll find the storage area for the wireless dongle, switches to toggle between the wireless modes and Mac and Windows modes, and finally a USB-C port. Then on the bottom, you get four rubber feet, some flip-up feet, and a sticker with the board name. Looking at the keycaps, the keycaps are made of a PBT plastic and are double-shot molded, measuring at about 1.2 millimeters of thickness. Durability isn't going to be a problem. The legends are part of the manufacturing process and will never fade or rub off. The legends, though, are pretty reminiscent of typical gaming OEM keycaps. As for the switches, the unit I have here is equipped with EpoMaker's Flamingo switches. These are a linear switch with an actuation force of 47 grams and bottoms out at 60 grams. It's got a flamingo color-themed pink and purple polycarbonate top and bottom housing, and dust-proof pastel pink palm stem. The switches are decently factory lubed and are really smooth even in their stock form. The stabilizers that the board comes with are plate-mounted with a pretty decent factory lube job done. Far from the worst I've heard, but could still benefit from a little bit of tuning. Now before I open this board up to see what's going on inside, here's a typing test of the board in its stock configuration. now I'm gonna take the board apart. Taking it apart is kinda tricky. What I'll do here first is take off all the keycaps followed by the switches. Then to get this thing open, you'll need to pry off the top case from the bottom case. The board uses a few plastic clips to stay closed. The clips are on really tight, so you're gonna wanna get your hands on some prying tools. Carefully use a card or some prying tools to get the board open. Don't do what I did here and brute force it open with a pair of tweezers and the screwdriver. I did end up scratching the board a couple of times where the seam is. So if you want to avoid a situation like mine, do be a little bit more careful. Once that's done, lift up the plate assembly carefully as the board does use a daughter board for the USB-C port and another daughter board for the knob. Carefully disconnect the JST connectors and the battery cable with your fingers or a pair of tweezers. The plate assembly is mounted using a gasket mount implementation with pour-on gaskets all around the sides of the top and bottom case. Instead of a silicone mold or EVA foam, the board comes pre-installed with some pretty high-quality pour-on case foam for sound dampening. A nice addition since it plays a part in the overall sound dampening of the board. Checking out the plate assembly, you get a steel plate, plate foam, and a pour-on switch pad instead of the more common PE foam sheet. Taking a look at the PCB, the PCB is south-facing and uses Kale hot swap sockets and has Perkey RGB. Definitely a welcome sight seeing budget boards like this start implementing south-facing switch sockets to avoid cherry profile keycap interference. The PCB does have support for screw-in stabilizers, though I've heard others say that only certain stabilizer brands like Akko's will manage to fit in with the stock steel plate. So a test fitting might be necessary if you want to opt in for screw-ins. Now I'm gonna rebuild the board with some aftermarket parts and a little bit of modding. For this build, I'll be relubing the stock plate-mounted stabilizers with Krytox 205 Grade Zero. The legs of the stems are already flat, so clipping the legs isn't gonna be necessary. After that, I'll be using two layers of masking tape and tape modding the back of the PCB to give it a little bit more help in the sound department. Don't forget to make a few cutouts for your JST connectors. Now as for the switches, I'll be using some lubed KTT Kang White switches. These are a 3-pin linear switch that bottoms out at 58 grams. They have a clear polycarbonate top, milky polycarbonate bottom, and a palm stem. These switches are known by the Keeb community to be pretty thocky on a budget, at just 27 cents a switch, so I'm curious to see how they'd hold up when used in this build. And finally for keycaps, I've gone with a set of Mauna Kea Series 1 White on Black Double Shot PBT keycaps for a more minimalist look. Now that the build's done, I'll leave you guys with the final modded typing test, and give my overall thoughts on the board right after. Okay, so for $90, I'd call this a pretty decent value pickup for sure. Let's talk about a few of the positives first. The board is built pretty well and sounds really good out of the box, with only some minimal work needed to get the stabilizer sounding clean. I honestly would have been happy just syringing the stabs with 205 Grade Zero. The south-facing hot swap sockets are a very nice inclusion, since it really solves the problem with north-facing sockets and Cherry profile keycap interference. The included EpoMaker Flamingo switches are honestly pretty good stock. I'd be happy to use them for other builds because the factory lube job is pretty consistent and makes the switch feel really smooth out of the box. And that's it for the positives. Now for the not so good stuff. One thing I need to mention right off the bat is that the board is a rebrand of another OEM keyboard, the Zoya GMK67, which is sold as a barebones kit at around $60 on other marketplaces. That board comes with a much nicer polycarbonate plate instead of a steel plate like this EpoMaker rebrand. It still has the exact same internals, same included foams, and same functionality. I think that the reason EpoMaker rebranded this board was so it would become much more accessible to a wider audience that would find it tedious and kind of a hassle to order a barebones kit from a Chinese marketplace like AliExpress or Taobao. If it were up to me, like buying this board as a beginner, I'd personally go for the barebones GMK67 instead, and use the money saved on some aftermarket switches and keycaps, since that's pretty much what I'd recommend doing with the EK68 in the first place. While the included switches and keycaps are decent, going for aftermarket parts really improves the board overall. I really just wish that EpoMaker went for a much softer and flexier polycarb plate or palm plate instead of a steel plate. The gasket mount implementation of the board is pretty much negated entirely because of the steel plate. While the board still has some bounce, it's definitely lacking in the flex department because of the steel plate. And I think that sums up all of the negative points I have. So yeah, if you're a beginner that wants a ready-to-use keyboard that looks decent and doesn't need any modding out of the box, or at least minimal modding, the EK68 is an okay pickup. All you'd really need to do is swap out the switches and keycaps and you're pretty much set. Alright, that's it for this video. If you enjoyed watching, feel free to drop a like, subscribe if you haven't already, and drop a comment if you have any questions. All relevant links will be in the description down below. Thank you for watching. Till next time, Merkeebs out.